This is the number one tool that I recommend non-developers explore when it comes to AI. The way that OpenAI Playground works is it creates a user interface to help non-developers visualize how the API works on OpenAI's side. This new Playground is very interesting for interacting with ChatGPT in a new way, but how can it help you actually automate parts of your business? Well, for that, we're going to need to go to our second tool, make.com. And here you can build an integration with ChatGPT directly. But let's give a specific example. I have here a Google form for gathering customer feedback. Now, let's say we want to not only receive customer feedback, but we actually want to automatically respond to customers. So all we need to do is trigger ChatGPT that every time we get a new row inside of this sheet, we will then automatically write a response and draft an email to that user. Take one. Today, I'm going to be showing you how to use an OpenAI API in order to automate your backend processes in your business. It's an ambitious goal, but I think we can do it together. So the first thing we're going to be doing here is we're going to be logging in to the OpenAI website. You're not going to be doing this from the ChatGPT website. Click on login here. From here, you enter in your information. From here, you're going to click on the API page. Once you click on the API page, you're going to be taken to what's called the ChatGPT Playground or the OpenAI Playground. The way the OpenAI Playground works is it creates a user interface to help non-developers visualize how the API works on OpenAI's side. What is an API? An API is an application programming interface. It's basically the user interface for code in order to talk to code. This is the number one tool that I recommend non-developers explore when it comes to AI. It also has a very different pricing model than regular ChatGPT. With regular ChatGPT, you have to pay a monthly subscription cost in order to access their premium features. With the OpenAI API, you pay per usage. And generally speaking, it turns out to be significantly cheaper than ChatGPT for most use cases. You'll have to set up your billing first. Navigate here to settings, click on billing, and click on payment methods. Click on add payment method, and you should be good to go from there. Like I said, the OpenAI's API is actually remarkably cheap for most use cases and for most businesses if you're not using it at a very, very large scale. But if you're paranoid about the cost, you can always go to the limits, and here, enter in your usage limit. This will stop OpenAI from charging you more than this set amount. All right, so let's explain how this works. You're going to want to navigate to the Playground part of the website. And here, the very first thing you should be looking at is the top left. There's three sections for you to explore when looking at the OpenAI's API. The first is chat. This is basically the same as ChatGPT. Then you have assistants, and assistants is the backend that powers the custom GPTs. So if you want to build a custom GPT, you can also do it here. And last is their legacy system or their original older system called Complete, which has been outdated since ChatGPT came out. It's called Complete because it works in a very different way than how ChatGPT behaves. In ChatGPT, there's a back and forth. Complete is the older version of the large language model, which instead it just completes a sentence that you're already writing. So here's an example. To be or not to be, that is the question, quote by William Shakespeare. It's completing the text that you give it. This is actually the original way that the large language models from OpenAI were built before ChatGPT came onto the scene. Most of what you're going to want to achieve with the API, you can do through the chat section of the API. And so this is what we're going to be focusing on first. Let's talk about the models. If you go here to the top right, you'll see the list of models that are available. Bottom line, you should probably just pick whichever is the very top model being displayed. If you want more information about the models, you can go to this page, which we will leave the link in the description below, and it describes all the models and what are the differences between them. Note that every time that OpenAI releases a new model, such as 3, 3.5, 4, later on going to be 5, it first releases the base model and then it releases a turbo version of the model. The turbo version is basically just a scaled up version so it can accept more tokens and it can do so at a cheaper rate. So we've selected GPT-4 Turbo. After that, we have our different variables. The very first one is temperature. Temperature essentially is a gauge on the amount of randomness you're going to allow ChatGPT to do. When you make temperature very, very high, its responses can be very chaotic and random, but it can also be more creative and can take leaps. In a way, it becomes more human. If you bring it all the way down to zero, it's going to be much more deterministic, significantly less random, and significantly more predictable. For most business applications of OpenAI, you're probably going to want to pick closer to zero, as we would like to have predictable results. In order to show you how temperature works, let's go back to the complete section. So you can see here at every single point is guessing the next word in the sequence, and it's guessing it from a list of possible options. When temperature goes up, it's more likely to pick those options that are less probable. Let's try a different example at a higher temperature setting. I'll set the temperature down to 1. Try for a longer one with jingle. So you can see here, sometimes it's selecting the most likely next word in the sequence, and sometimes it's selecting a word that's a lot less likely. If we increase the temperature too high, we can start getting really chaotic responses. In this case, complete gobbledygook. So you want to be careful if you set the temperature too high. After that, we have maximum length. This is based on the number of tokens that you want to consume from OpenAI. About 10 tokens is equal to approximately 7.5 words on average, and this will just depend based on your use case. This is somewhat harder to explain without a background in data science, but suffice it to say, it works in a similar way to temperature in the sense that by modifying it, you can increase or decrease the randomness or the unpredictability of ChatGPT's responses. But unlike temperature, in order to increase randomness, you actually lower the number. For most use cases, I recommend just leaving top P at 1 and leaving it alone. And if you really want to increase or decrease the predictability, I would just focus on temperature. After that, the last two variables are frequency penalty and presence penalty. These are variables that change how likely it is for ChatGPT to repeat itself. It puts a penalty on future words that it's guessing based on whether or not those words or concepts have shown up previously in the conversation. These I also recommend keeping to 0 for most business use cases. But you can see how if you wanted to create a creative brainstorming buddy or have a chatbot that emulated human conversation, it could be helpful playing with all of these variables and increasing the penalty, as more human conversation partners are more likely to jump around from topic to topic, as an example. With the variables out of the way, let's talk now about the system message. The system message is essentially the same thing as custom instructions you might give to ChatGPT. This is a message you're going to be giving to ChatGPT along with every single prompt in the conversation. For instance, you could type in here, "You are a pirate," that says "arg." And now if you ask, "What is the capital of Italy?" You'll see here it responds that way. This is a very exciting frontier when it comes to prompt engineering, and if you want to give better, more detailed instructions to ChatGPT on how you want it to behave. Something very powerful that you can do inside the playground that you cannot do inside of ChatGPT is you can control the responses that you get back. Why would you want to do that? Well, here's an example. Let's say you want to ask it math questions. You say, "What is 2 plus 2? 2 plus 2 equals 4. Well, if you ask, "What is 3 plus 3? You're probably going to get a similar response. But what if you don't want 3 plus 3 equals 6? You just want 6. Well, go into here, modify the answer it gave you before, and voila, you get 6. Because you need to remember that ChatGPT will look at the rest of the context above it when it's deciding how to respond. This is why it's so helpful to do prompts like, "Let's think about this step by step," because that makes it show you its reasoning and then give you an answer, as opposed to giving you an answer first and then trying to justify it. In a way, that's similar to human heuristics or our biases with commitment and consistency. This is an example of multi-shot prompting without just doing it all in the very first prompt. Multi-shot prompting is when you give ChatGPT examples of the type of answer in the type of format you want to give before you actually ask your question. I recommend that you check out the playground on your own device and mess around with it. And when you do, I would recommend you check out the examples part of the playground. You just navigate to the homepage and then click on prompt examples. And this was very helpful for me to understand ChatGPT because it gives you different examples that I wouldn't have otherwise thought of, and you can see its pre-built settings. All right, so how do we put this into practice? This new playground is very interesting for interacting with ChatGPT in a new way, but how can it help you actually automate parts of your business? Well, for that, we're going to need to go to our second tool, make.com. Make.com is my favorite integration software. It's similar in some ways to Zapier, and if you're more comfortable with Zapier, you can use that instead. But I prefer make.com because I find its user interface to be a lot more intuitive, and I find it to be also much easier to build multi-step processes with it. You can use make.com to integrate with almost any online process, but let's give a specific example. I have here a Google form for gathering customer feedback. Now, let's say we want to not only receive customer feedback, but we actually want to automatically respond to customers that use our feedback form, thanking them or addressing any major concerns that they have. So how would this work? Well, every time we get a response on the feedback form, automatically that response is sent into a Google Sheets. So now we're inside the make.com user interface. And here you can build an integration with ChatGPT directly. So all we need to do is trigger ChatGPT that every time we get a new row inside of this sheet, we will then automatically write a response and draft an email to that user. So here we are in make.com. You can see the very first module is already built. If you don't know how to get to this step, I recommend searching a make.com tutorial. Today, we're going to be focusing more on how to integrate ChatGPT using make.com. So what this module is basically doing is it's just watching for new rows inside of that sheet I showed before. And every time a new row appears, it's then going to trigger the next step in the sequence. That next step, you guessed it, we're going to be triggering OpenAI. Let's click on add a new module. Type in OpenAI. Select this. And now you're going to click on create completion. You can see here I've already set up an integration with ChatGPT, but you're going to have to add one yourself. The way that you do this is you navigate back to the playground, click on API keys, click on create a new secret key, and then I like to name my API key after the application I'm going to be using it with. Let's call this make.com. Click on create secret key, and now it's going to give you essentially the password it's going to use to access your account through the API. Once it shows you this password one time, you'll never be able to see it again. So it's really important that you save it in a place that you can access later. Take that API key and click on add here. And then you're going to have to add your organization ID. To get your organization ID, go back to the playground, click on settings, and you can find it right here. Once you have that, enter into make.com, click save, and you're off for the races. Remember that when make.com uses the API, it's going to also count to your billing. But once again, that's on a paper usage basis. And so long as you're not sending it thousands of prompts, you're going to be on a pretty low budget. So once it's set up, it's now time to program your module. Program it with low code. First, select the model you're going to use. If you remember, we clicked on GPT-4 Turbo Preview. This should automatically keep us to the latest version of GPT-4 Turbo, even when they release new models. And now it's time to add in our message. We have three options here. System, user, or assistant. If you remember, we can add in our system message or pretend like we are ChatGPT and enter in an assistant message. But for most use cases, you can just get away with just entering in a good user prompt. From here, you can type out the prompt that you want to give ChatGPT every single time, and you can give it the variables it received from the spreadsheet. So for instance, write me a response to the following feedback
we had on our application. Be kind and courteous, and assure them their feedback is being taken into consideration.
Then add in the place where you're going to be placing the variable. And if you remember from the Google Sheet, the column where the feedback was placed was column C, and their name was in column E. So if we add their feedback here, and also add in their name, then we should be good to go. Let's give it a shot. Click run once, and now we're waiting for ChatGPT's response. And bam, we got a response. Go here and you can see both the message that was given to it with the variables filled in and then its output. Click on message, content, and you can see its feedback. One thing that you might have noticed is it's added the subject line in its response. We don't want it to do that. So let's go back in here and modify the prompt slightly. Do not include a subject line in your response. Go straight to the email. Oh, and one thing is that you do have access to all the other variables. You might be asking yourself, if you're paying attention, where is temperature? Where is frequency penalty? Well, if you click on show advanced settings, all of those features are here and all of them are here to be edited and tweaked based on your use case. So actually, additionally, I'm going to change this to 0, keep top P where it's at. I'm going to keep these as blank. And I'll increase the max tokens to 500, let's say. Now let's run this again. I'm going to have to make it start over. So I'm going to click on choose where to start and click all. Click run. And here you can see its response. Straight into the email. From here, let's actually do something with this response now. The first thing that I want to do is I want to save it to the sheet so I can keep track of the responses for future reference. So I'm going to click on add module, Google Sheet, click on update cell. And this is going to be a module that updates the sheet where we had taken the data from. I'm going to select the spreadsheet ID from the previous module and same with the sheet ID. And for the cell, it was, I believe, column G. I must get the row number here. Add in the response from ChatGPT. The value we're going to be adding in is a variable from the choice. Let's try it one more time. There we go. After a short wait, you can see the response came right here. It looks like it added your name, your position. So let's update the prompt so that it has that information. Let's say your name is John Smith and you work at Valhalla.team. Test it one more time. And you can see right here, success. Now, what could you actually do with this response? Well, using make.com, you can actually create an email either as a draft or just straight up send it. You can integrate it with pretty much any other platform that make.com has access to. Let's show an example of actually sending the email from Gmail. Click on add module, select Gmail, select send an email. And then here you're going to have to select which integration. Once again, we've set this up so we already have many integrations already loaded up. I'm going to select my own email here. The subject line I'm going to write is we got your feedback. The content is going to be the message from ChatGPT. And the recipient is going to come from the spreadsheet. Because if you remember, we actually got their email address. And we're good to go. Let's try now. And now if we navigate to my email, sure enough, that email was sent. Now you'll notice here that the email got conjoined together. The reason for this is that Gmail on the back end actually reads things as HTML. And when it's HTML, it automatically concatenates all of the line breaks together. So in order to fight this, we're going to have to add in a little piece of make.com magic. Go here to the content, and then you're going to select the function for replace. The way that replace works is it takes a string and then it replaces any character inside of that string with a new character. So just select the output from ChatGPT again. Then you're going to select the thing that you want to replace. In this case, it's going to be the new line variable. And you're going to replace it with the break HTML tag, which is basically the same thing as saying new line. Let's test this out. And sure enough, you can see here, now it's working. I hope this video has taught you the power of make.com and the power that you can really unleash if you're using the ChatGPT API in your workflows. Until next time, this is Garik Tate. Thank you. Thanks for watching. And if you want to know how you can amplify your business with AI, you can click on the link below and that will take you to 5 case studies showing how we've implemented AI across our businesses.